Hello all, welcome to this video on linear algebra. Today we'll be discussing about orthonormal bases, orthogonal complement, inner product of functions and projections on one-dimensional subspaces. First we'll discuss the special case where the basis vectors are orthogonal to each other and where the length of each basis vector is 1. We'll call this basis the orthonormal basis. Let us see it more formally. Consider an n-dimensional vector space V and the basis b1 to bn. Then if the inner product of bi and bj is 0, for the case where I not equal to j and inner product of bi and bi is 1 for any value of I and j in the range 1 to n, then the basis is called an orthonormal basis. If only the first condition is satisfied, then the basis is called orthogonal basis. Note that the second condition implies that every basis vector has length or norm of 1. Assume that we are given a set b1 tilde to bn tilde of non-orthogonal and unnormalized basis vectors. Then we'll concatenate them into a matrix B tilde, which consists of the vectors b1 tilde to bn tilde, and apply Gaussian elimination to the augmented matrix given by B tilde, B tilde transpose followed by B tilde to obtain an orthonormal basis. This constructive way to iteratively build an orthonormal basis B1 to Bn is called the Gram-Schmidt process. We'll see a problem where we are asked to check if the given basis vectors are orthonormal or not. The given vectors are B1 and B2. So here we take the inner product as the dot product of vectors. So the inner product of B1 and B2 is given by B1 transpose B2. We see that the result is 0. Next we calculate the norm value for B1 and B2 and see that they are 1. Hence we conclude that both the basis vectors are orthonormal. We'll now look into vector spaces that are orthogonal to each other. This will play an important role when we discuss linear dimensionality reduction from a geometric perspective. Consider a d-dimensional vector space V and an m-dimensional subspace U. Then its orthogonal complement is given by this symbol, which is a d minus m-dimensional subspace of V, and it contains all the vectors in V that are orthogonal to every vector in U. Furthermore, when we take the intersection of U and its orthogonal complement, the value we get is a zero vector, so that any vector x belonging to the vector space V can be uniquely decomposed in terms of U and its orthogonal complement as x is equal to sigma m is equal to 1 to m lambda m bm plus sigma j equal to 1 to d minus m psi j and orthogonal complement basis vector bj, where lambda m psi j are real numbers and b1 to bm the basis of U and b1 to b d minus m the basis of orthogonal complement of U. Therefore, the orthogonal complement can also be used to describe a plane U, which is a two-dimensional subspace in a three-dimensional vector space. More specifically, the vector W, whose norm is 1, which is orthogonal to the plane U, is a basis vector of its orthogonal complement. All the vectors that are orthogonal to W must lie in the plane U. Then the vector U is called the normal vector of U. Generally, orthogonal complements can be used to define hyperplanes in n-dimensional vector and affine spaces. Hyperplane is a subspace whose dimension is 1 less than its surrounding space. For example, if the space is 3-dimensional, then its hyperplane is 2-dimensional planes. Affine space is a geometric structure that generalizes some of the properties of Euclidean space such that it doesn't have a fixed origin and no vector in it is uniquely associated to a point. Instead, there are only displacement or translation between any two points in space. In this diagram, we see the plane U in a 3-dimensional vector space, which is described by its normal vector w, which spans its orthogonal complement. The inner products we discussed so far were defined for vectors with finite number of entries. We can now think of a vector x belonging to the n-dimensional space as a function with n function values. The concept of an inner product can be generalized to vectors with an infinite number of entries, that is countably infinite, and also continuous valued function, which is uncountably infinite. Then the sum over individual components of vectors turn into an integral. Thus we see that an inner product of two functions u and v mapped from R to R can be defined as a definite integral given by the inner product of u, v, which is written as integral a to b u of x v of x dx for the lower and upper limits of a and b less than infinity. As in usual inner product, we can define norms and orthogonality by looking at the inner product. If this integral evaluates to zero, then the functions u and v are orthogonal. To make the preceding inner product mathematically precise, we need to take care of measures and the definition of integrals, leading to the definition of a Hilbert space. This mathematical concept was named after David Hilbert, where the methods of vector algebra and calculus from two-dimensional Euclidean plane and three-dimensional space are extended to spaces with any finite or infinite number of dimensions. Unlike inner products on finite dimensional vectors, inner products on functions may diverge since they have infinite value. In this question, we are given two functions, sine of x and cos of x. We need to check whether they are orthogonal or not. So f of x can be written as u of x into v of x, which is sine of x into cos of x. We see that this function is odd, which means f of minus x is equal to minus f of x. And when the limits are defined from minus pi to pi, this integral will evaluate to zero. Thus, we can say that both these functions are orthogonal. Projections are an important class of linear transformations besides rotations and reflections, and play an important role in graphics, coding theory, statistics, and machine learning. In machine learning, we often deal with data that is high dimensional. High dimensional data is often hard to analyze or visualize. However, high dimensional data quite often possess the property that only a few dimensions contain the most information, and most other dimensions are not essential to describe the key properties of the data. When we compress or visualize high dimensional data, we will lose information. To minimize this compression loss, we ideally find the most informative dimensions in the data. More specifically, we can project the original high dimensional data onto a lower dimensional data representation called the feature space and work in this lower dimensional space to learn more about the data set and extract relevant patterns. Machine learning algorithms such as principal component analysis, PCA, and deep neural networks heavily exploit the idea of dimensionality reduction. Even linear regression can be interpreted using orthogonal projection. For a given lower dimensional subspace, orthogonal projections of high dimensional data retain as much information as possible and minimize the difference or error between the original data and the corresponding projection. An illustration is given here. We see the two-dimensional data set, which is given by blue dots, and their orthogonal projection given by the orange dots onto a one-dimensional subspace, which is a straight line. Now let us define what a projection actually is. Let V be a vector space and U a subset of V. A linear mapping pi from the vector space V to U is called a projection if pi square can be written as pi composition pi given by pi. Since linear mappings can be expressed by transformation matrices, this applies equally to a special kind of transformation matrices, that is the projection matrices P pi, which exhibit the property that P pi square is equal to P pi. Assume that we are given a line, which is a one-dimensional subspace through the origin with a basis vector B, which belongs to this n-dimensional space. Then the line is a one-dimensional subspace U, which is spanned by B. When we project X onto U, we seek the vector pi U of X, that is closest to X. Using the geometric arguments, let us characterize some properties of the projection pi U of X. The projection pi U of X is closest to X, where closest means that the distance norm of X minus pi U of X is minimal. It follows that the segment pi U of X minus X from pi U of X to X is orthogonal to U, and therefore the basis B of U. The orthogonality condition yields that the inner product of pi U of X minus X comma B equal to 0, since the angle between the vectors are defined via the inner product. The projection pi U of X onto U must be an element of U, and therefore a multiple of the basis vector B onto U. Hence, pi U of X can be written as lambda B for some lambda, which is a real number. Here we see the projection of X, which belongs to the two-dimensional space, onto the subspace U with basis vector B. The projection point is given by pi U of X. Now we'll see the three steps where we are determining the coordinate lambda, the projection pi U of X, and the projection matrix P pi that maps any vector X in the n-dimensional space onto the subspace U. First step is finding the coordinate lambda. The orthogonality condition yields that the inner product of X minus pi U of X and B is 0. When we substitute pi U of X with lambda B, we get the inner product of X minus lambda B comma B is 0. When exploiting the bilinearity property of inner product of X comma B minus lambda into inner product of B comma B is 0. Hence, lambda can be written as inner product of X comma B by inner product of B comma B, which can be written as inner product of B comma X by norm square of B. In the last step, we exploited the fact that the inner products are symmetric and chose the inner product as a dot product. If the norm value of B is 1, then the coordinate lambda is given by B transpose X. Next, we are finding the projection point pi U of X. Since pi U of X is given by lambda B, as we saw before, we can immediately obtain pi U of X is equal to lambda B, substituting for lambda, which is the inner product of X, B, by the norm square of B into B, which is written as B transpose X by norm square of B into B, where the last equality holds for a dot product only. We can also compute the length of pi U of X as norm of pi U of X given by norm of lambda B, which is written as absolute value of lambda into norm of B. Hence, the projection is of length lambda times the length of B. If we use dot product as inner product, we'll get norm of pi U of X as B transpose X by norm of B square into norm of B, which can be written as the absolute value of cos omega multiplied by norm of X and norm of B multiplied by norm of B by norm of B square, which can be written as the absolute value of cos omega multiplied by the norm of X. Here omega is the angle between X and B. If the norm value of X is 1, then X will lie on a unit circle, which implies that the projection onto the horizontal axis spanned by B is exactly cos omega, and the length of the vector pi u of x is given by norm of, that is the absolute value of cos omega. Here we see the projection of a two-dimensional vector x, where the norm value of x is 1, onto a one-dimensional subspace that is spanned by B. Finally, we'll find the projection matrix P pi. Since projection is a linear mapping, there will exist a projection matrix P pi such that pi u of x is equal to P pi into x. With dot product as inner product and pi u of x is equal to lambda b, which can be written as b lambda, where lambda is substituted as b transpose x by norm square of b, which can be written as bb transpose by norm square of b into x. We'll immediately see that the value of p pi is given by bb transpose by norm of b square. A projection matrix p pi projects any vector x belonging to the n-dimensional space onto the line through the origin with direction b. The projection pi u of x is still an n-dimensional vector and not a scalar. We no longer require n coordinates to represent the projection, but only a single one if we want to express it with respect to the basis vector b that spans the subspace u, that is lambda. We'll see a problem where we are asked to find the projection matrix p pi onto the line through the origin that is spanned by the basis b. The formula for finding projection matrix is given by p pi, which can be written as bb transpose by b transpose b. And on substituting the values, we get the result here. Now we'll choose a particular value for x and see if it is lying in this particular subspace spanned by b. When taking x as 1, 1, 1, we see that the projection pi u of x can be given by p pi into x, where we substitute the values and see that the projection is belonging to the span of the basis vector b. That's all for now. Thank you for watching.